Apollo moon hoax conspiracists continue to repeat Kaysings' proletarian speculation that the lunar module's descent engines should have left noticeable craters on the moon. In Pseudonautics Episode 3, Soft Landing, Guillaume DOck attempts to prove mathematically that these craters should exist. Does his analysis do the job? First, instead of jumping right into the math, his video presents a couple of conceptual drawings of lunar landings from the early 60s. These are conceptual because nobody had made an actual moon landing before these drawings were made. Other conceptual drawings of that era don't have craters, but often contain radial scorch marks. And the LEM 7 patch, which Guillaume credits NASA for, is actually a Grumman patch. The limbs didn't just roll off an assembly line, one after another, on 2 weeks' notice. Each limb was handcrafted by a separate Grumman team, and each team had its own insignia. As the LEM 7, which flew on Apollo 13, was on the assembly floor long before Apollo 11 even went to the moon, it would not be unexpected to see an early 60s conceptual drawing on that team's patch. But so what? Where's the math he promised? Next, Guillaume turns to this Apollo 14 photo and thinks that the small divot in this photo is what Mr. Clavius, aka J. Windley, is referring to as an obvious sign of a disturbance. But for some reason, Guillaume totally misses the more obvious artifacts around the landing pad. Look closer. Notice the little pedestal of regolith on the backside of this landing pad, compressed under the landing pad itself so that it didn't blow away like the dust around it. Also, notice the sweep pattern showing the path of the dust as it blew away from under the lunar module. The astronauts took several photos of the lunar surface, and the only place you see these lines in the sand, so to speak, are under each limb. Now some math. The landing pad has a diameter of 36 inches. So there's about 3 inches of dust missing from around this pedestal that was eroded away by the lunar module's descent engine. Also, notice how smooth and compact the regolith under the limb looks compared to the undisturbed regolith just 5 feet away. In another mission photo, you see again how smooth the regolith is directly under the nozzle, while over on the left, there is an unmistakable sweep pattern that curves up to the edge of this 3 to 4 inch deep depression. We could go on with this, but let's get back to Guillaume's video. Still avoiding the math, Guillaume turns to what he calls a well-known 29 kilonewton rocket footage. It's a series of desert test firings of X-Corps' 7,500-pound thrust methane rocket. That's actually over 33 kilonewtons, Guillaume. Not only is this rocket engine putting out more than 3 times the thrust as the lunar module descent engine, its combustion chamber and nozzle are designed to be fired in an atmosphere. Let's pause for a wiki moment. The top picture in this chart shows an underexpanded nozzle. This results from the pressure of the atmosphere outside the nozzle being less than the pressure of the exhaust gases. This happens at high altitudes and in the vacuum of space, where the exhaust gases expand at the end of the nozzle. The second picture shows an ambient nozzle. In this case, the pressure at the end of the nozzle is equal to the pressure of the surrounding atmosphere. The pressure of the atmosphere keeps the exhaust gases from spreading. This is the most efficient design because it keeps the thrust focused in the opposite direction of the rocket's motion. Now, let's look at some real-life rocket engines. The engine on the left has a combustion chamber that's amazingly similar to the LEM descent engines, only without the expansion nozzle. This rocket is being fired in a near vacuum. Notice how the exhaust spreads rapidly as it leaves the nozzle? The engine on the right is being tested at normal atmosphere. Here, the ambient air pressure keeps the exhaust from spreading. The velocity of the gases from these two nozzles are similar, yet there is a dramatic difference in the shape of their exhaust due to the different ambient conditions. But what about the X-Corps rocket? Notice the tires on this two-axle trailer. They're standard 40-inch tires, plus or minus 2 inches. That means the nozzle on this rocket is 12 inches in diameter, or 1/20th the area of the lunar module descent engine's nozzle. And with 7,500 pounds of thrust, compared to less than 2,500 pounds for the limb, then yeah, whatever Guillaume says. I have to admit, if this 7,500-pound thrust methane rocket with a 1-foot diameter nozzle with 3 times the thrust and 20 times the exit velocity of the lunar module descent engine was placed on the moon, pointed straight down, 1 foot from a bed of regolith, held down with a 5,000 kilogram or 10,000 pound paperweight so that it didn't shoot out into space, and fired in the presence of a surrounding atmosphere equivalent to that of the Earth so that the exhaust doesn't spread out like it would in a vacuum, and let it burn for more than a couple of seconds, then, yeah, it could probably cut a hole through some lunar regolith. Duh. There's no comparison here. It's like taking a garden hose and partially covering the opening with your thumb. The water shoots out at a higher velocity and sprays farther before it falls to the ground. Do that and give the faucet a couple more turns to the right, and that's the difference between the X-Core rocket engine and the limb descent engine. Finally, more than halfway through the video, we get to the math. Guillaume shows that the lunar module would have a mass of 6,800 kilograms after using up 95% of its fuel. Okay, close. He converts that to 11 kilonewtons, aka 2,500 pounds of force, using the moon's acceleration of gravity. Okay, then he jumps to this mess. He says that to counter the 11 kilonewton pull of the moon requires that 3.41 kilograms per second of combustion products have to be expelled from the nozzle at 3,225 meters per second. Where did he get that? I faintly hear my high school math teacher, Mr. Sproul, yelling, "Show your work! You'll flunk out of college if you don't show your work!" Much to Mr. Sproul's credit, I eventually learned my lesson. Apparently, Guillaume has not learned his yet. What's weird is that Guillaume's numbers actually seem to work. Newton's second law of motion tells us that if the moon is pulling on the limb with a force of 11 kilonewtons, then by applying an 11 kilonewton force in the opposite direction, your net change in velocity should be zero. If you multiply these two numbers together, you get something very close to 11 kilonewtons. But then, any pair of numbers on this curve can be multiplied together to get 11 kilonewtons. So, how did he come up with this particular combination? To try to explain this, let's take another wiki moment and look at the ideal rocket equation. This equation says that delta V, the resultant change in velocity, equals VE, the effective exhaust velocity, times the natural log of M0, the starting mass, including fuel, divided by M1, the final mass after burning some fuel. The difference between the two mass numbers is called the flow rate, which is the mass of the propellants, that's fuel plus oxidizer, that you need to expel in order to change your velocity by delta V. If you simply plug Guillaume's numbers into this equation for the effective velocity and flow rate, you get a delta V of 1.62 meters per second, which is the acceleration due to the moon's gravity correct to three decimal places. Since this is the only place in Guillaume's video that he uses more than three significant digits and got the math right, he obviously had some help. Not only does this give us a hint on how he came up with this pair of numbers, but it also shows us the numbers are obviously wrong. That's right, Guillaume. You messed up, son. That's what you get for not showing your work. We're not going to have enough time in this video to finish the subject, so I'll just let Guillaume digest this for a minute. I'll be back to explain the major glaring error of his calculations in part two. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.